Come on over here. What's your question, Maria?
I was wondering what causes morning breath.
Like, why the heck do we have morning breath? Like, why is it? Like, and it's not even morning breath. You take a 2-hour nap, you wake up, you funky. Your mouth. What? It's like, I try to sleep with a mint, it doesn't work.
Yeah.
So why is that?
So this is really common. It happens to all of us. And basically, when we're sleeping, we're not producing as much saliva as we normally do. So our mouth gets really dry and bacteria can overgrow. So what can you do? Well, in addition to obviously brushing and flossing before you go to bed, drink a big glass of water. That'll help you stay hydrated throughout the night and it'll hopefully prevent a little bit of the morning breath.
Okay, you guys know when you're dating somebody, especially when you're dating somebody new, and you have morning breath, oh my God, I want to kiss you in the morning. You're like, we can't do that. So if you drink a lot of water before you go to bed, yeah, and you wake up with that new guy, it won't be as funky.
Exactly.
Nice, but then you're going to be peeing all night. But you'll be fresh in the morning.
The other thing is, as soon as you get up and he's still sleeping, just run to the bathroom and brush your teeth.
Just run to the bathroom and brush your teeth. How harmful is it? I have to ask you this, because I've never done this before, and I don't know, I've just heard some people have this concern, is like, how harmful is it to like wear the same panties 2 days in a row?
Yeah, you know,
Dr.
what?
Suzanne.
I love this question because this is so real.
How many of y'all wore the same panties 2 days in a row?
Oh, come on, admit it.
I have? Why are y'all lying? We are trying to be honest today. I just did a vagina show last season and talked all about mine.
Well, I have two, Tyra. I admit it.
You've worn them twice in a row?
Yeah,
why are y'all
so
lying? First of all,
it's a great opportunity to not be so freaked out about your body and what comes out of it. It's not that big of a deal. If you're that freaked out, turn them inside out. Or
inside
go
out.
Commando the next day. It's 2 days in a row, not such a big deal.
You guys hear that? Everybody in this audience that has worn the same drawers twice in a row that won't raise their hands? Okay, the next question comes from Paige. Where's Paige? Hi, Paige, stand on up. What's your question?
Sometimes I stay over at my boyfriend's house and I'll use like his toothbrush and maybe sometimes even his razor. And I was wondering if you could catch something from that.
So you use his toothbrush to brush your teeth and use his razor that he does his face on?
Like, what do you put it on? Legs. Oh. You know, you're in the shower.
Okay, tell me about that.
Well,
Dr.
in a pinch, it's okay to use your boyfriend's razor. Let's assume he doesn't have herpes or some other infection in his sleep. But a man's beard is rough and it'll dull the razor. So you're more likely to get razor burn or cut yourself. Also, guys like to use those razors with like 3, 4, and 5 blades. Those are not good for women. They're not good for a lot of men too. You can get razor bumps with those.
Okay, so don't use your man's razor. Now, what about his toothbrush?
Well, if you have to use a toothbrush, rinse it in really hot water first. It'll kill the bacteria.
Really hot water. Okay, Allison has a question. Where's your glass down on up, Allison? What's your question for Dr. Suzanne?
I've heard that it's possible to pee while having sex. Is that true?
You know, it may feel like it's going to happen, but usually that's
giggling
not
all soft.
That's a good question. It's not very common. I mean, most of the time, that's just sort of a sensation issue. Don't forget, everything's kind of all crowded in there together. Depending on position, what your anatomy is doing, you may feel the sensation. Most of the time, it will pass. The thing to do is go to the bathroom before you're getting busy in the bedroom, okay? And that's important not only so that you prevent any unwanted sensations, but also to prevent urinary tract infections.
Got it. I heard it's important also to prevent a urinary tract infection to use the bathroom right after you have sex
definitely.
As well?
Yeah, definitely. Before and after.
Okay.
Before and after.
So, like, how long can you cuddle before you get up to go?
You know, I don't think anybody's going to do a study on that. I think, you know, you should have a nice time, and then you should get up and relieve
yourself.
Okay,
got it. Okay, Brooke has a question. Stand on up, Brooke. Hello. What's your question?
As for one, we all hear these myths about olive oil, cocoa butter. How do we get rid of stretch marks? You know, we get them here, in the chest. How do we get rid of them?
I just got an email on TyraShow.com, actually, of a woman saying that she wants to be a model so, so bad, but she has stretch marks. What does she do about it? And I can't remember your name, but listen up. This is a question for you. Dr. Amy.
Well, stretch marks, 70% of us have them, if not more, and we get them as teenagers. That's when I started to get mine. If they're red or dark, there's prescription cream called Retin-A that will help lighten them, or lasers work. Once they're faded and they're sort of a little bit lighter than your skin color, right now there's nothing we have to do, unfortunately, except self-tanner will help. fill them in.
Oh, self-tanner
helps. And also, there's waterproof makeup you could use if you're for a day on the beach.
Sometimes if I go to the beach, I actually like put makeup on. Mm-hmm. But then if I come out the water, it's going away.
Buy some Dermablend.
Yeah.
It's waterproof. And don't tan because the regular sun will make your skin darker, but it won't tan stretch marks, so they'll stand out more.
Mm. So stretch marks don't tan.
They don't tan.
Interesting. Oh.
So what is it called?
Dermablend.
But they'll take up a self-tanner.
Okay, we'll be right back. There are medical questions that you're too afraid or embarrassed to ask your doctor. So our brave audience volunteers are doing it for you. They're going to be embarrassed today for you to get the answers. All right, now it's time to talk about something that can be really gross, but it's definitely really important. It's two things that come from down there. Numero uno and numero dos. Y'all know what I'm talking about. Number one and number two. Who has a question about going to number one or number two? You have a question? What's your name?
Dee,
what's your question?
Well, usually in the morning, you know, I go in and do my number threes, you know, one,
threes?
Two, three.
What's a three? What's a three?
A fart.
Oh, a fart. A three is a fart. Well, I thought three was diarrhea. Okay. Do one,
well,
two,
you
three.
Know, I usually turn around and check my progress. So, you know, I just wanted to know, what's the difference when it, you know, floats or sinks? Is it healthy or unhealthy?
Floats or sinks? You mean like the turd?
Yeah, your turd, it usually floats and sometimes it sinks.
So now I'm trying to think about... Fine. Who floats and who sinks? You guys don't know?
Well,
we need to start paying attention. So what should it do?
Am I eating healthy when it floats, or, you know, am I eating healthier if it sinks, you know, so forth?
It's a great question. Actually, for the most part, your stool should sink. Sometimes it can float depending on what you eat. If there is more gas produced in whatever you eat, that'll make it float.
Like soda? Like if you drink a soda?
Soda, beans, anything that's going to produce gas. But if you're consistently noting floating stools and they're very smelly, that could be a sign of a digestive problem.
Isn't it all smelly?
Well, there's smelly and then there's really smelly.
You're right. Because I feel like everybody can kind of take their own smell.
Right.
But every now and then you're like, I got to light a damn match and I did this. Right?
Exactly.
Okay, so I've heard that we should look at it. And how often do you guys look? Do you guys look at it? Yeah? Oh, now we're getting honest. I like this. We're getting honest. Yeah, you look at it because you want to know what color it is. You know, is it like, you know, little pop, 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 pops? Does it look like goat turds?
Right.
You know, because the goat turds are like the little niblets, like the little, like, do you know what I'm talking about? Or does it look like an elephant turd, like just a big pow? And it can be different. So what's it supposed to look like?
Yeah, first of all, it's great that you're looking because some people don't look. It is important to look. Now, I'm not saying you have to scrutinize it with a microscope, but take a glance at it. We actually have some great models here. It's not real, so no one can get grossed out.
What is that? What did you... What is that? It looks like granola dookie.
Yeah, I heard it's mostly edible, but I'm not going to try it right now. But yeah, so you're looking for a few things. Number one, you're looking for the shape. And you want it to be like a decent size and shape. This looks pretty normal to me. You don't want it to be too skinny or narrow. You see these like really skinny strips there. That could be a sign of something growing inside your colon that's causing the stool to be very narrow. So that's a little
worrisome. Or constipation. You know, like when you're pushing real hard and it goes, why am I saying this?
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, and then here we have these very small pebble-like stools.
The goat
tiny, again, a sign of constipation. And then this is the very loose, mushy stool.
Number three.
Could be a sign of infection, so you would want to get it checked out. You're also looking for color. These are actually all pretty fairly normal color, nice brown, but you want to watch out for red, a sign of blood.
Uh-huh.
That could be something dangerous. If it's very light colored, you could have a trouble with digestion or your gallbladder. And that's pretty much it. That's what you want to look for.
What if it's like dark?
Very dark could be, and I mean like black, could be a sign of internal bleeding from your stomach. And so that should be taken into account. But it can be black because of things like Pepto-Bismol, Mylanta. So if you're taking those medicines, you shouldn't worry too much.
Okay. What if, I have a question, like a wiping question.
Yeah.
Okay. I feel like when you wipe, you should look. And you should keep wiping until there's nothing left. Yeah. I have to ask you, is there a such thing as wiping too much?
Yeah, actually, we call people who do that the hyper wipers.
Hyper wipers.
And it is too much because you can really irritate your skin and you can actually cause some bleeding that way.
Oh, wow.
So you got to be careful of that. But yes, it is important to wipe everything away because if you leave some stool there, it can cause itchiness and irritation as well.
What about, look, I have so many booty questions. The wipies, like the wet stuff, like wet ones
right.
and stuff.
That's actually a good idea if you are one of these hyper wipers uh-huh. or if you tend to get constipated, because even a baby wipe, something moist, or you can just wet the toilet paper, it's much less abrasive to your skin.
I've been in the public restroom and I've seen women take paper towels and wet them and go into the bathroom. I'm like, you going to do number two and you're a hyper wiper.
Yeah.
The last thing I want to ask about number two is, what if you can see what you ate?
Yeah.
Like,
so
if
they
you
call
ate some
that
corn.
Deja poo.
Corn, rice.
Right. What is so, that? And corn is one of those things that it's normal for us to not be able to digest properly. It's
okay.
totally normal to see corn in there. If you're seeing a lot of other foods in there, though, you may not be digesting anything properly. You should get it checked out.
Okay. So we've talked about number two and number three and all that stuff. Number one. We're going to ask about number one. What should we look for when we pee-pee in the toilet? What do we see? Dr.
Well,
Suzanne.
I have some lovely samples here, too. I don't know how well you guys can see these, but over here, these are kind of the more normal. So what you want to do
Can you
do
hold
is,
up the normal ones?
Sure.
Because I know the camera's trying to get them, but
you
we can't
You want to kind of get
them.
An idea, and I'm going to talk a little bit about these. Sort of clearish yellowish. This is probably someone who really drinks a lot of water.
Yeah.
This is, you know, when it gets to that fluorescent color, this is your vitamins. Yeah. Okay. So sometimes
thank you, because sometimes it is like neon 80s up in the toilet.
Right, exactly.
And I'm like, and it's after vitamins.
Right. And some of that is normal metabolites, and some of that is, you know, guess what? You should eat your vitamins like in your food, because you don't absorb them very well. They go in your pee.
Oh, that's what it is.
Right. That's a whole other topic. But these are fairly normal looking, yellowish, clearish.
Okay.
This one is someone who's really not drinking enough fluid. And it can get quite dark and scant, you know?
Wow.
So real dark brownish. This also can be other, it can be liver, gallbladder problems. So if you're consistently having dark
Darker
brownish,
urine.
We also call it Coke, you know, Coke bottle colored.
Okay.
You should be seen by a physician.
Not good.
And it's smelling, right?
The last
it
one is
It will have a very distinct smell. And then this one, this
That looks
be,
like time of the month, Pete.
This one, you know, don't freak. I mean, first of all, this may be, oh, right, my period's coming. Okay,
yeah.
That might be that. But it also means, did you have a lot of beets? Rhubarb, blackberries can
beets
turn
make your pee reddish?
Yeah, they can. They can.
I knew it made number two
Not
reddish.
Not for anybody, but they
pee.
Can. So, you know, and again, it's a good idea to look and see, because it's a really good, this is a really ancient technique of checking health. This is how ancient physicians checked health. I mean, they used to taste it, too. Yeah.
What does it taste like?
Well, I wouldn't know. I'm not an ancient physician.
Last question. On a desert island, safer to drink your pee or salt water?
Pee.
Pee.
It's
pee.
Sterile.
Pee.
Drink your pee.
And it's sterile.
Instead of, I heard that pee
and it
is
won't
sterile.
Kill you, like,
y'all know what
yeah,
I mean by that?
Salt water will kill
like, you
yeah.
might be in a public restroom, you see people's pee all over the toilet, you think, oh my God, disease. No, the disease is what you can't see. That pee is not going to give you a disease, right?
That's right. That's
we'll be right back. Female panel of doctors answering our most pressing, intimate, and very embarrassing questions at times, these questions about our bodies. Sarah has a question. Where's Sarah? Come on over here, Sarah. What is your question?
I tend to only wash my jeans if they're really stretched out or if they have a visible stain. Is that okay?
How long do you go? Weeks?
Not weeks, maybe like 2 weeks, depending on how
Not
often
weeks.
I wear them.
Maybe
Not
two
like
weeks.
Multiple weeks.
Is that okay?
We were actually talking about this, you know, before, because we all agreed that, of course, your jeans do look better when you've been wearing them for a while.
Right.
And again, this kind of speaks to the underpants question, you know. Okay, so you've got some secretions maybe in there. Now, I know I recommended going commando before, so if you do that or you wear a thong a lot, you maybe want to wash your jeans a little more frequently. But honestly, unless there's some major, you know, blood or something on it, it's not
okay.
that big of a deal.
Got it.
I mean, you know, so you want to make sure the stink factor, too.
So if you want to wear your jeans more than, you know,
Do
you have
all
to
agree on that one?
Wear panties.
You don't want them to shrink, too, so they fit perfectly. You put them in the dryer, you've got to stretch them out again, so yeah.
Okay. Crystal has a question. What's your question, Crystal? Stand on up, Crystal.
I was wondering if it's possible to be allergic to condoms.
Yeah, it's actually fairly uncommon to be allergic to condoms, like between maybe 1 and 5% of the population has a true latex allergy that would be life-threatening. I think most people have a sensitivity to the condoms, and actually what I've seen in my practice more frequently is that the spermicide, if you use the lubricated condoms with the spermicide, people are really sensitive to that. So a solution is to use a water-based lubricant that does not have spermicide, and that should help. And if you're continuing to have issues, you should definitely see your doctor. Maybe something else going on.
All right. There's a question for Dr. Sapna from Martha. Hi, Martha.
Hi.
What's your question?
Okay, so I wear contacts like 24/7, 365. So sometimes I fall asleep with them. I want to know how bad that is.
And, that's good.
And also, I've heard that if like the contact comes out and you want to clean it because it's really dry, you can like put it in your mouth and your saliva is good for it.
Yeah.
Are those things true?
I've seen that all the time. I see people spit on their contacts. I wear contacts on the Tyra show to help me see my guests better and to read the prompter. And I don't do that, but I've seen girls be like, dang, I dropped my contact. Where's my contact? And they drop and they pick it up and they're like, and I'm just like, that is crazy. Is that okay? Because it's your own saliva?
Yeah, that's bad. Both. The answer to both the questions. And I've had contacts for more than 10 years. And I get it. I mean, I know at the end of the day, you're tired. You don't want to take it out. You may find yourself at somebody else's place or apartment. You don't know.
Yeah.
But those are two of the worst things that you can do. Sleep in them. Some contacts actually are extended wear contacts, which you technically can sleep in them. But even then, it's not a good idea. You're basically depriving your eyes of oxygen. You can get corneal ulcers, infections, and they're not uncommon. That happens all the time. There's more bacteria in your mouth than just about anywhere else on your body.
Other than your vagina.
or your colon.
Okay, so don't sleep in your contacts and don't lubricate them.
I win that one.
Don't lubricate your contacts
with them. With me in every bag, in every purse, in every backpack, I have a little small container of drops.
Little drops. Okay. Sedoni? Is that how you say that? Sedoni. Yes. What's your question?
Thanks. Well, I'm only 5'2" tall, and I wasn't blessed with height, so I've been wearing heels all my life.
You're blessed with cute.
So I've been wearing heels all my life. Wearing heels pretty much everywhere. So I'm just wondering, over time, the heels damaging to my feet after a while?
Are heels damaging to your feet? So, yes, heels are definitely, but does that mean we're all not going to wear them? No, because we've got, I think, all of them have.
She didn't wear flats.
You do have on flats. You're the only doctor with the flats on right now.
She's got flats on, but definitely they can. And not just your feet, which can cause bunions, corns, calluses, which are not just painful but ugly, but also can damage your knees, your back, your hips, all your joints, which we know, and so we still wear them. So really, what can we do? You can vary your heel height. That'll help. So at least you're switching it up and you don't have the stilettos on every day. You're putting pressure in the same spot every day. Bring walking shoes, flats to walk in. You can put those insoles in there. People go to great lengths. People have surgery to fit into their heels, surgery. The people inject fillers into the balls of their feet to wear heels, to go to great lengths. But there's ways to make it a little bit better.
But still stay fierce.
But still, because they're sexy. I know. I mean, what are you going to...
Okay, what's Samora has a bad habit. What's your bad habit, Samora?
Hi. Okay, I love the gym. I work out all the time, and after a good workout, I don't always wipe down the gym equipment. I don't see a lot of other people doing it either. Is that okay?
Do you wipe before you get on it? Like the nasty man before you?
Okay. No.
Not before or after,
because I get so into the workout and I'm like, I'm going to take a shower when I get home. So how bad is that?
Well, it's pretty bad because even if you're not seeing sweat, it's the microscopic bacteria, viruses, fungus, and yeast is all over that equipment. Yeah. So a lot of people take a towel and sit on it, but so what? You're wearing shorts or something. What's more important is where your hands go. So put a towel over where your hands are going to be. Or I was in a gym in Canada this summer, and they had this bottle of dilute hydrogen peroxide that everyone just spraying everywhere. It kills everything. So that's perfect. But definitely wipe it down.
Canadians are so cleaner than us.
They are very clean up
there. So much cleaner than us. Okay, Dr. Amy, what's the best way to avoid an infection when you're getting a manicure pedicure? Because I get scared because I don't like to pay a lot of money for the manicure or pedicure. Mm-hmm. You go to the hotels, child, you walk out, it's $200. So, like, I like to go to the places on the street, you know, to get a mani-pedi. How do you protect yourself from getting the infections that you see on the nightly news? Woman loses finger.
I love this question, and it's a little gross, but a very important thing to do when you're getting pedicure, do not shave the day of the pedicure. And most women don't know this. There's a bunch of studies around the country of women getting these really nasty bacterial infections on their legs, and all of them had in common that they shaved that morning. Because when you shave, you make all these little micro nicks in the skin, and it's a great place for these bacteria to crawl in. Also, people go get manicures and pedicures who have fungal infections and warts and all sorts of sort of yucky things on themselves. And the only thing that will kill that is bleach. But most of these places on the street only use bleach at the end of the day to clean out that water basin.
Oh, Lord.
So have the first appointment in the morning when no one else has been in that basin. So that's what I do. I go first thing in the morning.
Can you bring your own bleach?
Most places don't let you use it.
Like, you just had them, they're looking away, and you're like, yeah, girl, I want a French tip.
We can go with a team. We can distract them when one of us.
There you go. We'll be right back. Opening up to a panel of gorgeous doctors, I might ask. Aren't our doctors hot? Hot doctors. Okay, the next one. The doctor asks you, you know, do you drink? How often do you drink? You know, there's that little section. A lot of people say, oh, not much. Or, no, not really. I wasn't just drunk like this last night. Tell us, Dr. Raj, how important is that answer?
It's really important because your doctor may be prescribing medications for you. They may be ordering certain tests, and alcohol may have an interaction with those things. So it's really important. And I think what Suzanne just said, you know, we're not there to judge you. We're there to help you. We've heard it all before, and it's just really important to be honest about it.
Okay, now this one's going to Dr. Amy. This lie, when people say that they don't smoke, that they don't smoke at all. As a dermatologist, what do you have to say about that?
Well, for two reasons I'd like to know if someone's smoking. One is I prescribe the birth control pill quite often for acne. Mm. And if someone's smoking, especially if they're over 35, it's contraindicated. They could have a stroke, so it's really serious.
Wow, so it's a life lie.
It is. But, and the second reason is that in dermatology, I'm often doing procedures and operating, and people do not heal as well when they're smoking. So, and a lot of people don't know that.
Got it, okay. Now this is another one. This is, I think, very important. When people are asked, do they use any type of narcotics, meaning illegal narcotics? A lot of people use illegal narcotics. That's just, that's the state of our nation, the state of the world. The doctor asks you that. Do you tell the truth? Or do you fear going to jail or something and not tell the truth?
Yeah, we're not in the business of sending people to jail or calling the police. We're there to treat them as the best we can. And so it's really important to be honest. Narcotics are very important to know about. If you're going to do a surgery or a procedure like I do on people every day, if you're going to give them anesthesia, it's so important to know because they may need different medicines. They could have very bad reactions.
And what about even just normal medications?
That absolutely.
Could, like a cocaine or something could go bad with another medication.
Totally, yes. Absolutely, you need to know that.
Okay. Another one. When they come to you and they've had some type of infection, they're like, oh, I finished all my prescription antibiotics. I really did. You told me to finish the whole bottle, and I did. That's why I did. Okay, tell us about that.
Yeah, what happens is you start to feel better, and then you think, okay, I'll just stop. I think I'm good.
How many times have people done that? With the antibiotics?
Yeah, it's so tempting.
Because antibiotics, Dr. Sumner, they're like a miracle drug. It's like after day two, you're like, well, I'm ready to go back to the world.
Why should I keep taking this pill?
Yes.
But a couple things happen. It could kill most of the bacteria that it was treating, and then what didn't get killed could then resurge and then cause infection again, which is why you're back there.
What about if your friend has some antibiotics and you know that you take, penicillin,
so
and like, give me some of your penicillin, girl, I'm sick.
It's one of the worst things you can do. I mean, you may even look at it and say, oh, I think I've taken that before.
Yeah.
But there's a method to the whole madness of what's prescribed for what, why this is 3 days, why this is 5 days. Everything covers different bacteria. You're going to, A, not treat what you have, and B, hold off getting the treatment that you need.
And that one is illegal to take somebody's other medication. We'll be right back. Panel of doctors in the house answering the most embarrassing medical questions that we usually avoid asking because we feel like we're the only people in the world that have that issue. Somebody else has a question. Where's Amanda? Amanda has a question? Hi, Amanda. Let me come up the stairs to you. What's your question?
My stepmother has a fierce mustache problem. So what is the most effective way for her to get rid of that?
Is she going to be mad at you for saying that?
I don't really care.
No? Oh, you say you don't care. Ooh. Okay, what do we do about stepmom's mustache?
A lot of women have unwanted hair in their face. First, a lot of them shave. It's something that women don't talk about. A lot of women shave their face. I don't want any woman to ever shave her face. It's defeminizing. It makes a woman feel really bad and like more like a man. So I like permanent hair removal solutions, which would be either electrolysis or a laser, but waxing and plucking are fine also.
Wow. And then how do you tell somebody they have a mustache?
You can just say, oh, you know, I had a few extra hairs on the side of my lip and my doctor lasered them for me. I think I see like maybe a couple on yours, or have you ever done that?
Let's go together.
Right.
Okay.
It could be a stepmother-daughter bonding thing.
Where's Jill? Hi, Jill. Coming on down. Y'all are making me work today. Oh, okay. Jill, what's your question?
I was just wondering about discoloration on your tongue. Like, sometimes it can appear a little white in nature.
Oh, like the coating kind of thing?
The coating, yeah. I was wondering what causes that.
What does cause that coating, white coating on the tongue?
It's okay to have a little bit of a film on your tongue. We all get that. You were talking, Dr. Raj was talking about morning breath. And when what happens is you've got bacteria in your mouth and it just sort of forms that film. One thing you can do is brush your tongue. Every single time, it's actually good for your breath also. Every single time I brush my teeth, brush my tongue with the same toothbrush, just brush your tongue. And if it's really white, and it happens a lot, that could actually be something called oral thrush, which is a type of fungal infection. So if it's really white, and it happens a lot, that you do want to get that checked out. A little bit's okay. That's
I think the brushing the tongue is really important. I've even gotten an Ule. You know,
the scraper?
Yes, a tongue brusher.
Everybody.
They have them in the drugstores, mm-hmm. You know, and it's like this handle of a toothbrush kind of, and has a little thing, and you go, ugh. But I got this old-fashioned one. I got it from, what is his name? What is that Indian famous doctor man, and
Chopra.
He, like,
Deepak
heals the world? What's his name?
Deepak Chopra.
Yes, Deepak Chopra. He called me up and hooked me up. No. I went to his store, like, he has these stores, and I got this one. It's metal, and it's shaped like a U. Have you guys seen those kind?
Yeah.
And you
they
just
have
put
this
it
in India.
In.
I use everyone it every in single India. Morning.
Oh, they have them in India.
Yeah, everyone has.
They're great for bad breath also.
They're great for bad breath. And then you see all the white stuff come out, and then I do the sod, and then you... At least my breath ain't be stinking after I use it. All right, next question is Jennifer. Jennifer, come on over, Jennifer. What's your question?
Hi. This has happened sometimes in the past where something was really, really funny and a little bit of pee came out.
When you were laughing?
Oh,
yeah.
Oh, yeah. And I just wanted to know if something's wrong with me, or am I doomed to wear diapers when I'm an old lady?
No diapers. You know, first of all, I mean, I think most of us were girls, right? And most girls have a little more, many girls have more of that problem. And it's interesting, as you mature and the muscles and sort of the brain-body connection matures, you have less of that. Then as we age, that muscular sling that holds all your pelvic organs in can weaken. And you're not doomed to a diaper. What you can do is sort of preventative measures before you have kids is even the best. But I love Pilates and any kind of core stabilization stuff. It's really, really important. Kegels are sort of the easiest way to think of it, but Kegels are just the one little area, and really it's the entire pelvic floor. Do you guys know how to do that?
People know what a Kegel is. About 5 years ago, when I first at the Tyra show, I'd be like, what's a Kegel? And they're like, I don't know. I was like, well, we can all do it right now. Nobody's going to know.
That's right.
It's like squeezing those muscles down there. Okay.
But it's a workout for your pelvic floor, and what you want to do is prevent all of those organs from coming down, and then that will help you to hold your urine.
Got it, when we're laughing and when something's funny.
And many other activities.
Okay, so Tiara has a question. Hi, you've been talking in all this time.
I love you.
Thank you.
This is really embarrassing. Like, you know, like when you're with your boyfriend and you're watching a movie and you're all snuggled up.
What kind of movie?
I like 300.
Oh, okay. No. Okay.
But like, you know, and we're snuggled up and we're laying together and like I laugh and... And he's like, babe, you look like a lady, but you smell like a man. I heard about colonics and, you know, the enemas, and I wanted to know if you can do it yourself, because colonics are expensive.
Okay, so let's first talk about, like, the different smells of the farts and why sometimes it doesn't smell and sometimes it does. Dr. Raj?
Yeah, so basically, depending on what you eat, it's going to affect how it smells. And there are certain foods that react with bacteria in your intestine and produce sulfur, and that's the really smelly stuff. So eggs, some other dairy products, meat, cheese, those can all do it. And in terms of how much gas, you know, we all produce gas. It's normal. Most of us produce about a liter a day. And pass gas about 8 to 20 times a day.
8 to 20 times a day?
That's normal. And, you know, men tend to be a little less discreet about it, maybe, than women. But it's totally normal. It's not something to be embarrassed about.
So if it really, really stinks, does that mean you have to go to the bathroom?
If there is stool in the colon that's about to come out and the air passes through, it's going to be a lot
stinkier. Stinky. Okay, we'll be right back. questions. I know Christine has a question. Christine. Hi, Christine. I'll come on up to you. What's your question, you. Christine?
Whenever I drink a milkshake or, you know, anything really cold, I get really bad brain freeze. So I was just wondering if there's a way to prevent it or what causes it.
Yeah, how do you get rid of it? Like, it is like you feel like you're going, and you want it to go away.
Right.
How do you make that feeling go away?
So first, let's talk about what's happening. Basically, when you eat something very cold or drink something very cold, the roof of your mouth gets cold, some blood vessels there constrict, but then when they relax and dilate, they almost over-dilate, that rush, you know, sends a rush of blood to your head and it causes a headache. So what can you do? Well, first of all, if you eat or drink that cold thing more slowly, it's less likely to happen. If you put your tongue to the roof of your mouth, you can warm it up more quickly so the cold won't have as much of an effect. That could help, or drinking some warm liquid right afterwards.
Okay. Yeah, I heard that putting the tongue in the roof of the mouth will help it.
Yeah.
Like, do you put the back of your tongue in the mouth?
Or if you can really curl your tongue, sort of the back of your tongue.
Yeah. Oh, okay. Got it. Okay, Stephanie has a question. Hi, Stephanie.
Hi. My question is, what is your funny bone, and where does the term come from, funny bone?
Yeah, when you hit that thing, it's like, it ain't funny. Right? It's like... Who's going to answer that one?
I'll answer that one.
Okay.
So your funny bone is not a bone. Your funny bone is actually a nerve. It's the ulnar nerve. It goes right along the inside of your elbow, and it's really close to the skin, and it's by the bone, which is why it can hit it. But that's the feeling that you're getting. It's the nerve going down to your hand. And the reason that it got its name is, could be because it causes the funny feeling. Also, the bone in your arm is called the humerus, which is spelled a little bit differently, but that's possible. But yes, there's the joke. What's the only bone in your body that you can't break?
Your funny bone. This is not a bone.
It's a nerve.
Okay, is there anything that we can do? Is there anything that you... So we just learned, you know, putting the tongue on the roof of the mouth to make the brain freeze go away when the funny bone is doing that thing. Is there anything you can do to make it stop?
To make it stop once you've hit it? You just kind of have to wait.
You have to wait it out.
Yeah.
Okay. Dr. Amy, I know a lot of people have heard this wives' tale. I don't know if it's true, and I hear it all the time when I go to the beach. I heard it a lot in Jamaica. That if you get stung by, Jamaica, man. Oh, yeah. I've been there a couple of times. Okay, I don't know what accent that was. Anyway, that when you get stung by a jellyfish, that if you pee on it, it'll heal it. You guys heard of that? Yeah. So is that true, or is that...
It sounds yucky, but it works.
It does?
Because the pee is acidic. And it neutralizes the toxin from the jellyfish.
Uh-huh.
Now, if you have vinegar, that'll work just as well, but in a pinch.
So you pee on your skin, not the jellyfish. Okay. Your own pee, or do you tell your boyfriend, pee on it, pee on it? Can it be anybody's pee, or does it have to be
anybody's
your own body?
Anybody's pee.
Anybody's pee.
Remember, it's sterile. It's sterile. It's sterile.
Uh-huh.
Pee in a cup and then pour
pee
it on.
Pee in a cup and pour it on.
Just have your boyfriend do it.
Okay, Nashira has a question. Where's Nashira? Hi, Nashira. Come on over. Wait, come on over. You look like Adriana Lima. Supermodel Adriana Lima. You look like her.
Oh, thank you. I get hiccups all the time and always in the worst places, like at a job interview or at the movies. So how do I get rid of them?
Wow, is it nerves? Because she says job interview.
What? Nerves can actually trigger a hiccup. We don't know a lot about what causes hiccups. We know what's happening. It's a contraction of your diaphragm. It causes a sudden outburst of air, and that's the noise that you hear. We think it could be triggered by eating something too hot or too cold, drinking a lot of carbonated beverages, acid reflux can do it, sometimes nerves. In terms of stopping it, this is one of those areas of medicine that the old wives' tales are actually as good as it gets. We don't have a lot of great cures.
Breathing in the bag and all that stuff.
Breathing in the bag, drinking some cold water, putting sugar on your tongue. And we think that this works by disrupting the nerve that affects your diaphragm.
Got it. Okay. We'll be right back. Thank you, doctors. You guys. So amazing, so enlightening, right? I mean, there's all the questions that you just don't want to ask, and you guys answered all of them. We don't feel like freaks anymore, okay? Now, I know a lot of women have a lot of issues with their bodies today, and there's so much more that every woman needs to know about. So there's some things that we do every single day that could have serious consequences that could even be deadly. What are they? Go to TyraShow.com to find out. It's really important, and we'll see you later.